Next is the periapical abscess. Periapical abscess is a localized collection of pus in the alveolar bone at apex of teeth following the death of the pulp. This periapical abscess can be of two types, acute or chronic. First, we'll see about acute periapical abscess. In this case, the tooth is non-vital. There may be rapid onset of pain that is localized and slight tenderness to intense throbbing type of pain, and there may be marked pain on biting. In this acute periapical abscess, we can observe a swelling that is palpable and fluctuant, and the patient may have fever. White blood cell count gets increased, and tenderon percussion is present in acute periapical abscess. In radiographic findings, there may be widening of the periodontal ligament space, and the lamina dura is intact. Management includes dryness of the abscess should be initiated as early as possible. This may include root canal therapy, incision and drainage of the abscess, or in case of tooth which cannot be saved, or in case of the abscess that is very large and cannot be treated conservatively, the tooth should be extracted. And systemic antibiotics, which includes the amoxicillin and clavulinic acid 625 mg twice daily for 5 days, and metronidazole 400 mg thrice daily for 5 days has to be given. For the relief of the pain, anesthetics should be prescribed to the patient. Next is a chronic periapical abscess. It is a long-standing low-grade infection, and it is a asymptomatic, which means the patient doesn't feel any kind of pain. Here there may be history of extraoral or intraoral swelling along with pus discharge, and on clinical examination we can observe there can be a slight elevation of the tooth from socket. Swelling causes the vestibular alterations, and tenderon percussion is absent in this case. Here you can observe, let me show, there may be intraoral sinus. This is an intraoral sinus. We can observe there is a root stems here, and here there is a sinus formation. This is a radiograph. Gutta percha is placed from the sinus. Here you can see it is reaching to the apex of the tooth, and here is the extraoral sinus. And this is a paralis, also called as gum boil. So the radiographic features include, in this case there will be widening of the periodontal ligament space and break in the continuity of the lamina dura. Treatment includes antibiotics, NSAIDs, root canal treatment for the tooth that can be saved, or extraction for the teeth which cannot be saved, along with the dryness of the abscess. This periapical abscess can progress into phoenix abscess, periapical cyst, osteomyelitis, cellulitis, or it may cause endoperior lesion, or it may remain silent due to antibiotics. Next is the phoenix abscess. It is also called as acute exacerbation of chronic periapical abscess. What happens here is, the patient will be having asymptomatic type of pulpitis, which means at the periradicular area there will be equilibrium state, but influx of the necrotic products from the diseased pulp or bacteria and their toxins cause the dormant lesion to react, which means the asymptomatic situation gets activated due to necrotic products, and that dormant lesion gets activated. This leads to acute inflammatory response. Clinical features resemble acute periapical abscess, which means the patient will be having the sharp pain and all. swelling, sharp pain, and radiographic features resemble the chronic periapical abscess, which means radiolucency, widening of the periodontal ligament. Periapical cyst, it is also called as radicular cyst. This is the most common odontogenic cyst, which is one of the sequel of pulpitis. This periapical cyst is a true cyst because it is lined by the. So the pathogenesis of the radicular cyst, in this there are three phases: phase of initiation, cyst formation and cyst enlargement. In case of initiation, what happens is there will be cellules of melasses at the periapical area. So these cellules of melasses, they get initiated by the inflammatory products from the bacterial infection of the pulp, and they start to divide and increase in the number. For their survival, they need nutrient supply. So these nutrients, they get diffused from the adjacent connective tissue into the epithelial cells, but the innermost cells doesn't get any nutrient supply and they start to die, and this process is a liquefaction necrosis. So due to liquefaction necrosis, there will be increase in the protein content and also increase in the osmotic pressure. When there is an increase in the osmotic pressure, the fluid that is present in the adjacent connective tissue area, they start to go into this, and increase in the fluid content happens here with lining of the epithelial cells, and finally the cyst enlarges in the size. This radicular cyst is common more in the males than females, and commonly seen at the age of 30 to 40 years, mainly in the anterior maxillary region. In this case, we can observe asymptomatic swelling associated with non-vital teeth and expansion of the cortical plates, displacement of the teeth and resorption of the root tip. On radiograph, we can observe a well-defined radiolucency that is more than 1.5 cm with corticated border. This is a corticated border. There is a radio-opaque border, you can see. Here we call it as a corticated border. And this is a radiolucency. This is a photograph of the patient, clinical picture. You can see the swelling that is present in the palatal area. And on radiograph, there is a radiolucency at the apical area of the central and the lateral incisors with the peripheral corticated border. Treatment includes enucleation of the cyst, extraction of the tooth with extensive lesion, or the endodontic treatment of the tooth with apicectomy. This is a flow chart of the sequel of the pulpitis. So first is a pulpitis. This can be reversible or irreversible. This irreversible pulpitis can be of the acute and chronic type. Okay, this pulpitis leads to apical periodontitis, and this apical periodontitis can lead to either cellulitis, periapical abscess or periapical granuloma. This periapical granuloma can lead to periapical cyst or osteomyelitis. This periapical abscess can lead to osteomyelitis. Again, the cellulitis can lead to osteomyelitis. This is a gross flowchart of the sequel of pulpitis. Try to remember this. Thank you.